Good evening. I'll call the meeting to order for the purpose of electing a chair and vice chair, and I'll just ask for a nomination for the position of chair at this time. Councillor Holland.
Thank you, and I would like to nominate Councillor Neal as chair.
And Councillor Neal, do you accept that nomination? And is there a seconder? Councillor Sanek. And are there any other nominations at this time for the position of chair? Okay. And Councillor Bone, would you accept that nomination?
Yes.
And is there a seconder? Councillor Neal? All right, are there any other nominations? Okay, so seeing that, I will close nominations for the position of chair. There's two candidates, so we will now vote. Those in favor of Councillor Neal? I see four. And Councillor Bone? Two. All right, so Councillor Neal is appointed as chair, and I will now ask for nominations for the position of vice chair. Councillor Neal? Councillor Holland, do you accept the nomination? And would someone like to second that? Councillor McLaren, are there any other nominations for the vice chair position? Seeing none, I will close nominations. And all those in favor? Opposed? And that carries. And I'll just pass the chair now to Councillor Neal.
Thank you very much. A couple of things. I have read the agenda, but I wasn't expecting this, so thank you very much. And I, of course, don't have my glasses, so I'll have to hold the agenda like this to be able to read it. But I will call the meeting to order. And I'm looking for approval of the agenda. Mover and seconder. Councillor Sanek, Councillor Holland, any corrections, additions? Seeing none, all those in favor? Carried. Confirmation of minutes, and looking for a mover and a shaker. I wasn't at the last meeting, so we'll need a... Thank you. Councillor Sanek, seconded Councillor McLaren. Any corrections? Seeing none, all those in favor? Carried. Disclosure of pecuniary interest. Seeing none, we have no delegations. We do have a briefing. And it's just getting set up.
Through you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to have Paul Robertson, City Curator, speak to the report before the committee this evening. As you probably recall, the commemoration strategy was approved through ARC and Council in October of 2015. It's a project that Paul played a significant role to carry forward, and he's done the same with the policy piece working with stakeholders across the corporation, and so he's going to step through some key points for the benefit of the committee.
Thank you very much. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So, a process, the phase two or step two of a process that started in 2014, looking at Kingston's commemorations, and it's been an exciting ride. I'm happy to see that the policy is now before you, and that we'll be able to implement the Kingston commemoration strategy, which was passed, as you heard from Mr. Wigginton, passed in October 2015. So it's been a long haul, but I believe we've got a solid document that will give us a really effective tool to implement the strategy and to move forward in an effective way, working with commemorative requests here in the community. Okay, mister. It's not moving. So, just by way of a little bit of background, as you may remember, if you were here for the presentation we did back when the strategy first came forward. What was driving the impetus to create the strategy and now the policy very much was the character of Kingston. In other words, this community, as we all know, has a very strong affinity with its history and has in many different ways worked hard to acknowledge that history, certainly through our tangible and intangible commemorations, through our museums, through our historic buildings, through our various historical societies. It's in Kingston, this is the way we do business. It's very much part of the fiber and character of this community. And as evidence of that, the Civic Collection has at least 80 different tangible commemorative pieces. And certainly that was a driving force for staff in making the recommendation. We needed to somehow corral this and have a more effective way of working with it. And what we discovered quickly was that there was no consistent municipal approach for looking at various tangible and intangible forms. And around the same time that we were thinking of this, it was also at the time we were looking at the Public Art Master Plan, which of course now has a public art policy, and we wanted to be able to coordinate the heritage and art side together. Just by way of a quick review, what is a commemoration? The way it's defined in the strategy and in the new policy, a commemoration is an intentional act of acknowledging the memory of people, places, events, and ideas. And commemorations can be public or private, national or local, tangible or intangible, monumental or modest in scale, permanent or temporary. This does sound like a study in contrasts, but what it's trying to capture is the essence that this policy looks at commemorations in a particularly holistic and inclusive way, and that we're looking at a broad range of things that could be considered commemorative. And as you look at the policy and what I'm about to show you again, you can see how that plays out. So just by way of a quick review of the strategy itself, passed in 2015, the need was established that we needed to establish a clear and consistent and consolidated protocols and decision making to respond to community request. In fact, what drove the request back in 2014, what to look at this was actually a myriad of requests that were coming to the city at that time for various types of commemorations in city parks. And when those came up for review, we realized we had no consistent strategy. We had no consistent criteria for how to assess those things. So it was clear the community needed something, wanted something. We had to be able to address that. We'd like to, by way of looking at the stories, the narrative of this community, foster a multifaceted dialogue on people, places, events, and ideas with particular significance to Kingston's cultural heritage. And again, how that's defined is played out in the policy. And it certainly pertains to commemorations on city property that require city approvals. This is not meant to cover all commemorations within the municipal bounds of Kingston. If it's on private property, non-city owned spaces, then this doesn't apply. As I described, the purpose of the policy itself, to implement a cohesive and overall vision for commemorations. The strategy makes it very clear that there is a long-range vision. It's actually a 10-year plan that will be reviewed in 2025, where we think commemorations should be going, and how we can foster that interest within the community. We'd like to coordinate the existing commemorative policies that exist within the city. That was the one thing in doing the research originally. There are quite a few. Just a couple of examples, the policies that we have around commemorative trees and benches, for example. Those were there and in place, the policy for proclamations. Those were in place, but each was managed by separate departments. Nothing knitting them together. So this commemoration policy umbrella document that links all of those parts, particularly what was wanted was a transparent and streamlined decision-making process. As I mentioned back in 2014, when we were trying to assess some of these commemoration requests in city parks, we had no criteria to follow. So this document establishes that. And it's also to improve customer information and service. So the role of the Heritage Resource Center in particular, it's now key. That becomes a frontline portal for people making application to ask questions, and also a city website portal that has, we hope, when it's complete, will have all of the basic frequently asked questions that will be there. It'll help to stream people to the right place they need to go to discover if the thing that they're asking for is in fact a commemoration or perhaps is something else. And it certainly to clarify the roles, or clarify the management, I should say, of the city's existing commemorative collections that we have now. I mentioned the 80 that we do have at present. Something coming out of the strategy from the research that was done in the Kingston Commemoration Strategy when we were doing public review was a general sense of what commemorations do people believe are missing, what do we have now and what we think is missing. This has been repeated within the policy, and so what we're looking at is a thematic balance in new commemorations with, for the next, this 10-year cycle, First Peoples, ethnocultural communities, Francophones, and women. Coming out of the public consultation, those areas were clearly identified as important. When we were doing the work, of course, we were at the height of planning for the Sir John A. Macdonald bicentennial, so there was lots of discussion about what was going on and how he had been commemorated within the city. And I think that partly prompted people to think outside the box, so to speak, other groups that we wanted to include. The policy outtakes commemorations, which I've mentioned before, is a pretty inclusive list of things. These are all things, again, specifically programs that the city is offering now. We didn't invent any new ones. We just tried to corral all of the loose parts that were there and bring them together in some sort of form. We grouped them into three categories, and what differentiates the categories is basically the amount of city resource, the decision-making required, the time frame to deal with each of these types of requests. So a category A is considered a pretty straightforward thing to do, and you can see for things like a tree and bench dedication, we have an existing policy. There is a form which will be corralled through the web portal, but in terms of making an application, but that's a pretty straightforward request, and there is a policy, clear policy that outlines what that is. We included council motions, so if things that honor aspects of people's lives, again, that's a fairly straightforward process that doesn't require an advisory body to decide what to do or not with that. That last one, third-party displays and exhibitions on city property, that was more a way of dealing with requests that we get on occasion, and you'll see them around City Hall at different times. People say, I'd like to put a display on for a day. Can I borrow one of the committee rooms? I'd like to show my collection of First World War objects. Can that be done? So that what that means is that we would get the request and we assess whether or not that's appropriate in that place and time, and can we accommodate it because there's space. Category B, medium amount of processing, as you can see. And this takes a little bit more, again, reasonably straightforward because there is, in most cases, a procedure already in place. Things like displays, exhibitions, and partnership with the city, that would be if we were doing a community banners, a commemorative type banners, or that kind of thing. Then that's a decision making within the staff level. Are we doing it? Do we have budget? What are the logistics? Tours, which would be like City Hall tours. Again, that's an established process or specific tours that someone asked for with, for example, in City Hall or some other city facility. That's fairly easy to arrange. Festivals or ceremonies. That could be ceremony, in this case, could be a smudge ceremony, a request for a smudge ceremony. So again, that can be decided at the staff level. Proclamations, there is an established way for doing that. Flag raising, same sort of thing. The heritage property markers, those are those little bronze, I call them the bronze buttons, but the markers that we put on designated properties within the city. Again, our colleagues in planning, building, and licensing have an established way that those happen. Oh, and as you see, we're thinking ahead when the illumination happens here at City Hall. We've built that into the policy, so it's already in place. Assuming someone would be able to make a request for a specific commemorative event, then there will be a procedure for handling that. The category C is the one that is the most involved and certainly requires a higher level of scrutiny and more consultation, both from within the city and without. Naming of corporate assets, of course, which could be a building, a street. There are established policies for that now, which fall under the commemorations policy. But there is a much more intensive process. What does that mean? And I'll take you through the process in a couple of minutes. What does that mean? How does it fit? Can we accommodate it? What are the costs? Those kinds of things. Kingston Remembers plaques, which you'll see slowly blooming around the city, because we're dealing with historical narratives and looking at them from an accuracy point of view, absolutely, the applicability, those require a certain level of scrutiny. Someone comes to us with an idea. One of the questions we certainly ask is, you know, what's the story and why do you want to tell it? But also, are there funds attached? The example I can use is when the former Alcan, Novellus approached us a couple of years ago to say they'd like to celebrate their 75th anniversary. They came to the table with a budget in place to say we would like to do a Kingston Remembers plaque to honor our 75 years here in Kingston, but can you help us tell that story? And so we didn't have this specific policy in place, but we had the strategy, so we were able to take it through the steps and say, yes, that's appropriate. Yes, we have a space that we can work with. We worked with our colleagues within the city to say, okay, how do we process it? How do we install it? Where can it go? All those kinds of things. So that's the level that would the level of processing time, shall we say, that is required. Medium and long-term physical commemorations. That the example one might say for that would be our Alderville First Nation. This will be coming to council later in February. The Alderville First Nation project that we've been working on for the last 3 years with Alderville First Nation to do a commemorative piece. That has been a complete process of working with the community to determine the needs, the desires. It's going to come ultimately will be a public art piece telling the story of the Alderville First Nation, the Mississauga people here in the Kingston area. So that has been an extended process, but working specifically with them and then with colleagues in our departments, particularly recreation and leisure as it comes to parks development, to establish that we have appropriate spaces that fit community needs in Kingston, fit the needs of the Alderville First Nation. And of course, one-time events, festivals or ceremonies, one example would certainly be the Sir John A. Bicentennial work that we did back in 2015. That's clearly of a commemorative nature and did require extensive city resource to implement. This is a way of trying to describe the shared responsibility. As I've said before, the policies that are in place, the commemoration policy becomes the umbrella policy for all the existing policies that were already there. So it's not doing away with them, it's just trying to knit them together into a cohesive fashion. So those policies are generally owned, maintained by different departments, and that graphic I've got there gives a range of the various departments that are implicated by the commemorations work that the city is doing right now. The central portal becomes, as we work with our colleagues in planning, building, and licensing, and with strategic communications, to build that web entry portal and also to bolster the strength of the Heritage Resource Center to be able to handle requests as they come in. So that in a general sense, and this largely is a graphic that would describe something the more straightforward, like category A or category B, someone comes in and says, I would like to do a proclamation, what do I do? What's the process? Then that would be directed to the clerk's office. And there is the policy, there's the protocol for handling a proclamation, and that's said and done. This emphasizes the fact that it's not just cultural services is certainly taking a lead in making sure that the policy runs well and the process continues, but it's very much a shared responsibility. The approval level for Category C is the one that requires the most steps and certainly the most input from various groups, both within and without the city. So I'll take you through this process very quickly, and then I can give a couple of examples of how that could work. The as I've mentioned, the request would be received by the HRC or through the web portal, which is then directed. Cultural services, in this case, if it's a Category C type thing, so that's, as I mentioned, an example is like a Kingston Remembers plaque or a community-led festival, those would then be funneled to cultural services, perhaps to first to ensure that the file is complete. Do we have the questions answered? Do we know what it's talking about? That then it triggers a meeting, and these meetings would happen a couple of times a year, so that we're not dealing with these repeatedly. It would be what we're calling an interdepartmental commemorations group, and that is representatives of the various departments who are involved either in commemoration specifically or would have to be involved if we're installing something or creating something. So that's a combination of groups like Public Works or Recreation and Leisure, Cultural Services, Planning, Building, and Licensing. It just depends on what is on the table at that time. And that's the group that would first look at city resource, for example, timelines, workload, all of, you know, where does this fit? Is it appropriate from a city administration point of view? Does it coordinate with other things that the city has on the table at that time? But that being an internal group, this is now would trigger the public consultation. And again, like a Kingston Remembers request, that would be opportunity for the public and experts in a particular subject matter to be able to comment. The public consultation process that we have envisioned is working through Heritage Kingston, specifically our Cultural Heritage Working Group of Heritage Kingston, who, with the members of that particular working group, do include a number of people who are conversant with Kingston's history and the cultural scene here. And if required, the policy allows for other experts to be brought in. If it's a subject-specific, a cultural community piece, then that doesn't have the expertise on the working group, then that's the opportunity to bring someone in for public consultation. That information is then funneled back to staff, and the idea is that they're our advisors. You know, is this the right thing? The public consultation would be looking at looking through the lens of a strategy, which includes a variety of criteria by which to measure these things. Some of it is practical things. Is this subject already covered? Is it duplicated several places? Is the request from the proponent in a place that is most appropriate to it? Is it part of going to add to more clutter, shall we say, in City Park? I mean, that's where that consultation takes place. This also gives us some of the information we need as staff to be able to work with the proponent, because there will be times when a request comes in that may not fit the criteria specifically, so that gives us the flexibility, and the policy is very clear on this, to be able to work with an applicant to say, okay, maybe the form you're looking at isn't the best one at this time, but perhaps we could look at something else. So if at the end of that process it's agreed that this should go ahead, if the proponent has the funds in place, which also is important, if it's externally funded, then approval can then proceeds to implement in the timeline. If it's under 50,000, then it can be done at the departmental level, and if it's over 50, then it would come to council the way the strategy is, or the policy is written. So the couple of examples that I was going to suggest, one of them, you will remember a year or two ago, the Valor District. And at that time, there was certainly a lot of staff work on that, absolutely. Historical background, the various resources required, the logistics to implement it. But one of the underlying comments that came through that was, we have a commemorations policy in the works. Perhaps we should defer a final decision until we actually have the procedure for looking at this most effectively and see how it fits the criteria established in the Kingston Commemoration Strategy. So that what happened would be is the process I've just described is Valor District, when the policy is approved, we would be able to take Valor District through a process similar to what I've just shown you. And
I'm yes. Sorry to interrupt. We're just beyond the 10 minutes, but oh. I think I would be happy if someone wanted to move waiving the 10 minutes for the completion. Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Continue on.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Almost done. So the Valor District, if people remember, you know, to put up specific street signs in the area around Barrack Street to honor soldiers from Kingston, or military people, I should say, from Kingston, particularly as it was coming in our First World War commemoration. So these are the types of steps that we would use to look at that. Another example that came through council, of course, is the rock that was donated by Vicky Keith, connected with her swim back in 2005, I think it was. That could perhaps if we were when we finally place it with some type of interpretation, could be done as a Kingston Remembers plaque, for example, and a storyline describing what that rock means and perhaps linking it to other cross lake swimmers, something like that. That could happen. But this would go through, again, a similar process to look at it in the context of the broader story of Kingston. So just by way of wrap up, the recommendations that we've asked for in the report to accept the policy so that we can actually implement it, to lift the moratorium, which, if you remember, has been in place since 2014, on all new commemorations on city property in waiting for this new policy, and also to repeal the Kingston Remembers bylaw, which is the one that first put the Kingston Remembers program in place, which in review, when we looked at it through the consultant and with our colleagues in planning, building, and licensing, realized that provisions within it were actually in contravention of the Planning Act in requiring property owners to put up a plaque in specific instances. So the Kingston Remembers program is being administered through cultural services, so that original bylaw isn't as applicable as it once was. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And questions or comments comments come later. Questions from the, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, thanks so much for the presentation. So we get a lot of requests to us as counselors. So with this new policy, I'm just looking at the first step, right? So Heritage Resource Center web portal. Mm-hmm. So for instance, Valor District, that came to me, right? So with this new policy, do I just refer them, like the web portal, does that mean the customer service contact center? Or like what do we do as a counselor if something comes to us? Do I just send you an email and you call? Like, I just don't understand that very first step.
Through you, Mr. Chair. The web portal would be essentially a web page with appropriate information and links. So it would be directing someone directly to the city website. It doesn't exist yet. I mean, it would be like a dashboard almost of what are my options, and so that you as or any of you as counselors, if you got a request like that to say, if you're looking for information specific to your idea, your request, I just direct you to the website, and you'll find the specific page. That would be able to lead you through the options and steps.
And we do have a question from Director.
Just a further clarification, if I might, through you, Mr. Chair. To your point, Councillor Osanek, this is also part of an education process for the public as well. So to your question, I would suggest rather than just handing someone off to the city website and this web portal that will be put in place, that you can direct people to contact staff. And I think one of the big messages we need to get across to people is that we won't be responding on an as-request basis, that we'll need to be making it clear to people that there's this process in place, that these groups will be meeting a couple of times a year. And so that request would be captured as part of that process and then brought forward for review through this process that's been outlined. And so it will potentially create some anxiety on your part as mm-hmm. the member representing the constituents to help them understand that we will respond, and this is the mechanism, and it will be given its due consideration, and then they'll be able to have an outcome from the process reported back to them.
Great. Yeah, that makes me feel a lot better. It takes the pressure off of us, too, to start to gather up votes and bring it as a motion and all the rest. I really like that. So just my closing remark is when that web page is up, make sure we all know, because we'll be really looking forward to that. Thank you.
Absolutely. There will be a whole communications plan around it so that I think it's one of those ones that we'll have to repeat quite often, because the interest is out there in the community. It's just getting, as Mr. Wigginton has said, it's getting the community used to the new process. We're not ignoring them, but it's just a different way of dealing with them.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you very much. Any further questions, comments? Seeing none, if the vice chair could take the chair, I just had a couple of quick questions. First of all, the Kingston Remembers. We have a lot of, and rightfully so, a lot of heritage-type historical plaques that various levels of government have sponsored here in the city. I came across a plaque on Young Street near College that I found really, really interesting, that the Toronto Heritage Society or Historical Society had put up. We don't often have plaques. History is the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we seldom put plaques up for the bad or the ugly. And there was a very interesting plaque on Young Street that commemorated the historical riots against the Greek community because Greece was neutral in the First World War. And I found that a really moving kind of one. If we could make that kind of effort, I think that would be really, really good historically. City signage. I know that we have some district signage. The university district, for instance. But I've been asked over the last few years about the idea of other historical districts, like a lot of other cities do, like historical Williamsville or Portsmouth Village Historical District, even though these aren't heritage districts or aren't yet heritage districts. Is that some kind of a consideration that would fall under this kind of umbrella with some council direction?
I would say yes, because this the policy gives a framework for analysis, both from an historical research or appropriateness point of view, but also it would have to look at resources and just how do we implement that type of thing. We, as I understand it, the University District came about slightly differently, but that's why...
And co-funded, which
yes,
was helpful.
Yes, whereas the Valor District, which was not a specific neighborhood per se, but a concept, an idea, came about, or I should say, came about before this policy was in place, but the way the policy is written, it has the meat, it has the teeth to be able to deal with that and look at it, which would probably set some precedent for how other neighborhood districts might be looked at in future.
Thank you. And I know there was some discussion. Oh, yes, Colin.
Mr. Wigginton.
Thank you, through you, Vice Chair. I just want to clarify, too, Paul's made reference to the Cultural Heritage Working Group, and our colleague Jennifer Campbell is here as the manager of Cultural Heritage, and she works very closely with that group. And there's also strategic work that's going on, so this process isn't just about responding to public inquiries around particular requests. There's work that will always be ongoing around, say, things like Kingston Remembers, about trying to strategically tell our stories in different ways and exploring the kinds of issues that you've raised. But I do think that the notion of historic neighborhood descriptors is also something that group can be looking at, because certainly there would be as many opinions as there are people. You know, I've heard interest in recognizing Picardville, which was known historically as a very Francophone part of Kingston, but doesn't exist in the streetscape. So how do you decide between a Valor District, Picardville, Portsmouth Village? So I think staff will be taking a very proactive stance to try and look at how we can tell the Kingston story and how we can commemorate it through various signage initiatives.
I appreciate that. Would be great to see a plaque that commemorates the suffragette struggles in Kingston, or the general strike in 1919 by workers and soldiers coming home from the war. So that kind of thing doesn't often get celebrated. So that's great.
You can submit your feedback to the web portal.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So
we talked about a walk of fame some time ago, and I know that it was kind of deferred because we were coming up with this policy. I'm wondering if that's still on anybody's radar. Yes?
Defer to you.
Through you, Vice Chair. it's my understanding that that project, the Walk of Fame, was actually put on hold pending work on Block 4 as part of the North Block development, that those two things were tied together, and when the city makes progress on how it wants to proceed with the redevelopment of Block 4, that the Walk of Fame would be looked at in that context. Because there seemed to be a tremendous amount of interest in seeing the Walk of Fame associated with that part of the city. If it were to be revived or brought forward in a different way, potentially in a different part of the city, then you know it could be looked at a second time or renew that discussion within a different context. But that's my understanding.
Thank you. And my very final comment, the commemorative trees and benches, I know that there was some concern with the revitalization of Victoria Park that some of those trees and that might get lost. And I appreciate that Luke's department assured us that if a tree was removed, the plaque would go on one of the new planting. Now that this is being done, do we have a kind of written policy that makes that commitment to people? So if we have a revitalization of a park and we shift benches around or have to lose a tree or two and replace it, how will we work through that?
Mr. Falwell?
Through you, Vice Chair. So yeah, that's available within the policy, certainly on the bench, because there is now a time component attached to that. So we don't anticipate relocating benches within that time period. But if it is a memorial bench in, say, Victoria Park, then we would notify the individual if we have enough information to do so, to at least let them know the next time they come to the park that bench has relocated as a result of the renovation. On the tree side as well, it's my understanding that if a tree as part of a renovation needs to be removed, then there would be a new tree attached to that, so we should be covered.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I'm done.
Thank you. I return the chair.
Thank you. We'll now go to the public. If anybody wishes... I'm sorry. I apologize. So if we're done with the briefings, then we'll move on to the business portion, and then we'll give committee an opportunity and then the public. Thank you very much. So no further questions or comments. We'll open it for the public. Yes. I think you know the drill.
So thank you, Mr. Chair. Frank Dixon, Williamsville resident. I want to start off by praising the extensive work by staff and ARC and the very high quality and thorough consultation that was done, that was described, and an excellent presentation today. And I just maybe a couple of points to add on this. I'm just wondering, what we're going to have now. Like, we're near the finish line on this. This could be finalized, and then it'll go to council. How does what we have now actually compare with what other cities are doing, both in Ontario and Canada? So, don't necessarily you need an answer on that now. But I'm just wondering if you looked at what other cities are doing when you were shaping the policy that we have now. And then I guess just sort of following along in sort of the vein of what Councillor Neal was talking about with one of his points. I'm going to use a Toronto example, which really struck me. I was down there. So on the corner of Spadina and Bloor, which is right next to UTS, they have a series of plaques which talk about the story of the Spadina Expressway and how it was the concept was developed, and it was discussed by council and the Ontario government and so on, and it was eventually stopped. And there are illustrations there. So I found that as a very striking story to be told, because it wasn't actually built, but it was a very controversial topic and even remains so today. And I guess maybe just sort of right next to that, there's a place called Matt Cohen Park, which is just right on the side of UTS. So Matt Cohen, the late Matt Cohen, was a well-known writer and poet. He's actually born in Kingston. So what they have there is a series of plaques that are describing some of the stories and poems that he wrote in the context that he wrote them and how they're tied to that neighborhood, because he lived nearby for most of his time in Toronto. So I found that to be just an extraordinary work that was done. I really learned a lot from it. So it seems that what we're doing here is sort of opening the door towards that kind of really high quality work, which we weren't able to really put together until now. So I'm really encouraged by that. And I guess my final point is, you go around Kingston and you see all kinds of different aspects of our history and people who are notable who are actually remembered. And that's excellent. But the thing that's interesting is how many major pieces of history or figures are actually not there at all. And the example I'm going to draw on is Oliver Mowat, who was born in Kingston. He articled with Sir John Macdonald, moved away due to rivalry with Macdonald, and became Prime Minister or Premier of Ontario for longer than anybody else ever. And he was also Attorney General of Ontario and later served federally as well. So there's almost nothing in Kingston about Mowat. And we're coming up to the 200th anniversary of his birth, which will be in 2020. So I'll just sort of put in a mention that that's really a major omission that we need to find a way to deal with. So thank you.
Thank you. Any comments from staff regarding some of those points?
Through you, Mr. Chair. I can answer or comment on all three of those things, I think. The first one, the research that went into the strategy and the policy, at the beginning of this process, we looked to see if there were any other jurisdictions that were doing what we thought we wanted to do. What we were finding is at the municipal level, not so much. There are individual policies that deal with things such as benches and trees, and individual plaquing programs, but not a holistic vision to what commemoration could be. The two examples that we found that were useful, but they were at a national level. One was Canberra. Actually, they were both sort of like national capital type commission groups, one in Canberra in Australia, the other here in Ottawa. They were two examples of of strategic visions, a sort of review of what's there and a strategic vision of what commemoration in those national capitals should be. So we took that and of course modified it to fit our context here, and I think what's come out has speaks very much to the community here in Kingston. The reference to the other stories is what I'm calling it. Some of the, and this has been mentioned as Mr. Wigginton said, our goal is to have ability to respond to requests for doing the stories which are not necessarily part of the commonly known narrative, but also to be able to build that in and more strategically so that over the course of years that we have a roster, if you will, of different subjects that we think we would like to look at, both staff-generated and ones that we do through consultation, looking at the community and what stories do we feel need to be told. And certainly the Oliver Mowat one, he's on my list. You've mentioned it, Mr. Dixon, before, and I certainly do remember that. We're quite inclusive in what gets considered. It's more a question of how that fits into timelines and what can it be linked to in some cases, if it's an upcoming anniversary or a festival of some sort.
Thank you very much. I know the Rideau Canal has some national plaques that are more the kind of standard historical, but there's a wonderful plaque at Kingston Mills that recognizes particularly the Irish workers who died in the building of that. So that kind of thing, I think, there is a gap in our remembrance plaques for that kind of thing. So we'll move back into committee. Is seeking a mover and a seconder? Thank you. Councillor Bohm, you got that, eh? Councillor Bohm. Yes. Seconded? Yep. Any more comments or questions? I think we've had a thorough discussion. I'll call the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you very much. That was an excellent report. We'll move on to business item B. It's the approval of the Kingston Arts Council plan for administration of arts funding for the Corporation of the City of Kingston. And this came to us via the advisory committee. So is there... Oh, that's okay. I thought you were heading up to the podium. You're sneaking out. You're sneaking out. Okay, we won't notice. I was wondering why he was going to the podium. Yes, the director probably has some words of wisdom.
This is the new level of integration. The director of Rec and Leisure is going to speak to the City of Kingston Arts Fund. Through you, Mr. Chair, just a few quick words, as this committee is very familiar with, under the terms of our service level agreement with the Kingston Arts Council, they are required to do a review every year of the City of Kingston Arts Fund, and they have done that through 2016. And what you have before you is a report that summarizes the work that was done and highlights six major areas within the administration plan that have had some modification to them. One of the things that I've been impressed with that the Arts Council has done in the last couple of years, and you also see in an appendix there, where they've done a very thorough review of not only the administrative plan, but also how that content then translates over into the guidelines and the applications that people fill out as well. And so there's a level of rigor that continues to be pursued with this granting program that I think we all agree is extremely successful and valued by the community. So at this juncture, looking for the support of the committee to carry this forward to council for approval so that we have this framework for the 2017 plan.
Thank you very much. Any questions from staff? This is the kind of an annual report that comes through the advisory committee here. No questions? Okay, we will, routine and annual. Any member of the public wish to speak? Seeing none, I will entertain a mover and a seconder for the recommendation. So it's now on the floor. Any further questions? Seeing none, all those in favor and none opposed. Thank you. So that ends our business for today. We're going to get home at a decent time. Although I'm 5 minutes late from going to the movie I wanted to go to. That's my fault. I talked the most. Notices of motion. Seeing none. Other business. Seeing none. Correspondence. I don't believe we've received any. Date and time of next meeting. February 23rd. I will, and I've mentioned to the clerk, I am going to a winter symposium on behalf of public health. So I'll be absent, but I'm sure that Mary Rita will do a stellar job. So my regrets for the next meeting. Motion to adjourn. All those in favor?